All right, so today we're going to look at the Great Pyramid, but like from a completely different angle.
Yeah, you know, forget like pharaohs and tombs and all that. We're going full on science here, like hardcore math and radar imaging.
SAR imaging, right?
That's the one synthetic aperture radar.
Yeah.
It's some pretty wild stuff.
So we've got this 2022 research paper, right? It's by Filippo Biondi and Corrado, Malanga, and it was published in Remote Sensing.
Yeah, and what's really got us hooked is figure 14, you know? They've got these crazy detailed SAR views of the pyramid.
Okay, so let's break this down, because most people, when they think pyramids, they're thinking ancient Egypt archaeology 101.
Right, like Indiana Jones stuff.
Exactly. But that's not our game today. Yeah. Our mission is a bit different.
It is definitely different. We're going down a rabbit hole here, a very specific rabbit hole.
Which is?
That this pyramid, maybe it wasn't just a tomb, like maybe it was some kind of crazy ancient power plant.
Whoa, okay, so not just a really impressive burial site, but like something technological.
You got it. And that's what's so cool about this theory. It's like mind-blowing, but it's also based on real science, on actual data.
So it's speculative, but not just like totally out there.
Exactly. And it's making us rethink the whole pyramid thing. You know, instead of just focusing on the cultural stuff, the who and why, now we're looking at the hey W.
Like how it was built, how it functions.
Yes. Yes. And that's where the SAR imaging comes in. It's giving us a whole new perspective on these structures.
And the main idea here is that the pyramids weren't just these isolated wonders. They were part of something much bigger.
A network. Yeah, like an energy grid spanning ancient Egypt.
And the pyramids were tapping into some kind of natural energy source.
They think it was the Schumann resonance.
Okay, the Schumann resonance.
Which is like this electromagnetic hum that the Earth gives off. It's always there in the background.
And they think the pyramids were picking up this energy and then beaming it wirelessly to the obelisks.
Exactly, like those tall pillars you see all over Egypt.
So it's like ancient Wi-Fi powered by the Earth itself.
Kind of, yeah. And you know that Ankh symbol, the one that looks like a cross with a loop?
Yeah.
They think that might have been like a tuning key for the whole system.
Okay, now we're getting into some seriously out there territory.
I know, right? But hold on, because it gets even crazier. They're comparing all this to the work of Nikola Tesla.
Tesla, like the electric car guy?
Well, yeah, him too. But I'm talking about the OG Tesla, the guy who was obsessed with wireless energy transmission way back in the early 1900s.
Oh, right. So they're saying the ancient Egyptians were doing Tesla-level stuff thousands of years ago.
Yeah, that's the implication. Yeah. And it all hinges on these SAR images. So tell me in the simplest terms, what is SAR imaging?
Well, it's like using radar to take a super high-resolution picture of the ground.
Okay.
So a satellite sends out radar signals, they bounce off the pyramid, and then by analyzing those signals, we can build up this incredibly detailed map of its shape and its composition.
Cool. So it's not just about what we can see on the surface. It can tell us about the inside of the pyramid, too.
Exactly. And this figure 14 that we keep mentioning, it's got three parts, right?
Yeah, it does.
What's the main takeaway from each of those parts?
Okay, so part A is a grayscale SAR image. Think of it like a black and white photo, but instead of light, it's showing how much radar signal was reflected.
So darker areas mean less reflection, brighter means more.
You got it. Gives us a good look at the pyramid's surface. Now, part B, this is where it gets juicy. It's a color-coded map, but it's not showing colors like you'd see with your eyes.
Okay, so it's more abstract.
Yeah, it's showing something called phase differences in the radar signals. Basically, tiny changes in the way the waves bounce back.
Changes like what?
Like micro-movements on the surface, or even slight variations in the internal structure of the pyramid.
Hold up, micro-movements. You're saying this massive stone structure is moving.
On a microscopic level, yeah.
Yeah.
And part C, this zooms in even further, showing these movements in even more detail.
So this is really high-tech stuff, not just a regular satellite photo.
Oh yeah. This data came from the Cosmos SkyMed satellite system. It's an Italian system, yeah. Second generation, super advanced. They even have this staring spotlight mode to get those crazy high-resolution images.
Staring spotlight mode sounds intense.
It is. Basically, it's staring at the pyramid, gathering tons of data.
And it's by comparing these multiple images that we can see these tiny movements, right? That's the interferometric part of SAR.
Bingo, interferometric SAR, or INSAR. It's all about looking at the differences between multiple images to detect these super subtle changes.
Now we're talking about changes on the scale of micrometers, right?
Micrometers to millimeters, yeah. Like fractions of a human hair.
Crazy. So what could possibly be causing these tiny movements in a structure that's like, you know, thousands of years old and made of solid rock?
Well, they think it's mostly natural stuff, like wind vibrations from Cairo, even the flow of the Nile River.
The Nile, really?
Apparently, even that can create these subtle vibrations that travel through the ground and into the pyramid.
So instead of this static, unchanging monument, what we're actually seeing is a structure that's constantly vibrating, even if it's just a tiny bit.
It's like the whole pyramid is humming.
Whoa. Okay. So how does this all tie into the idea of the pyramid being some kind of energy resonator?
Well, to understand that, we need to think about the sheer size of this thing and what it's made of.
Right, the scale of it is mind-boggling.
Totally. So just to recap, the original height was about 146.5 meters. Each side of the base was roughly 230.4 meters.
So the base is like a giant square.
Yeah, and that gives it a base area of over 53,000 square meters. And then the total volume of stone is estimated to be nearly 2.6 million cubic meters.
That's a lot of rock. Now, all that weight must create some serious pressure.
Oh, yeah. If we assume a typical density for limestone, we can estimate the pyramid's total mass to be about 6.48 billion kilograms.
Billion with a B.
Billion with a B. Now, inside the pyramid, particularly in the king's chamber, there's a significant amount of granite.
And granite has some interesting properties, right?
Yeah, it does. Granite is piezoelectric, which means it can generate tiny electrical charges when it's compressed or stressed.
Yeah.
And with all that weight pressing down on it, the granite in the king's chamber is under immense pressure.
Like, how much pressure are we talking about?
We're talking roughly 1.2 million pascals. So that's enough to potentially generate some measurable electrical charge within the granite itself.
So the pyramid is like squeezing electricity out of the rocks.
In a way, yeah. And now let's go back to those micro movements we saw in the SAR images. Remember that formula that links phase difference to displacement, delta 5 equals 4 pi over lambda times d?
Vaguely.
Yes. Well, using the radar wavelength from Cosmos SkyMed, which is about 0.031 meters, we can calculate that a full 360-degree phase difference that corresponds to a movement of about 15.5 millimeters.
Okay.
So those color variations in the SAR image, they're showing us oscillations in the pyramid ranging from sequentially zero movement up to about 15.5 millimeters.
And these oscillations are happening in response to those natural vibrations we talked about, like the wind in the Nile.
Exactly. And here's where it gets really interesting. They think these oscillations could be in sync with the Earth's own electromagnetic frequencies, specifically the Schumann resonance, which is about 7.83 hertz.
So the pyramid is like vibrating along with the Earth.
That's the idea. But here's the thing. If we treat the whole pyramid as a simple electromagnetic cavity, we can calculate its fundamental resonant frequency based on its size.
Yeah, what do we get?
We get a frequency of about 1.02 megahertz, which is way higher than the Schumann resonance.
So their frequencies don't match up. How could they be interacting then?
Well, that's where the idea of higher order modes or acoustic resonance. Well, if we do that, we can calculate its fundamental resonant frequency for sound. And what we get is about 16.38 hertz.
And that's?
That's pretty close to the first harmonic of the Schumann resonance, which is around 14.3 hertz.
So even though the pyramid as a whole might not be resonating at the Schumann resonance frequency,
yeah,
maybe specific chambers within it are tuned to those harmonics.
Precisely. And this gets even more interesting when we consider the piezoelectric properties of the granite in the king's chamber.
Because those vibrations could be generating electrical energy.
Exactly. Now let's talk about the obelisks, those tall pillars.
Right. How do they fit into this whole energy network idea?
They think the obelisks were acting as receivers for the energy that the pyramid was potentially transmitting.
Okay.
Now, if we model a typical obelisk, say one that's 25 meters tall as a vertical antenna, we can calculate its fundamental resonant frequency.
And what do we get?
We get a frequency of about 3 megahertz.
Again, way higher than the Schumann resonance.
Right. So how could they be effectively picking up this energy if their resonant frequencies are so different?
Yeah, it's like trying to tune a radio to the wrong station.
Exactly. This suggests that the obelisks might have needed some kind of mechanism to tune them to those lower frequencies, or maybe they were designed to receive energy at those higher harmonic frequencies.
Okay, but let's assume for a minute that the pyramid IS transmitting energy, how far could that energy realistically travel? And how strong would it be?
Well, electromagnetic waves tend to spread out as they travel like ripples in a pond, and as they spread out, their intensity decreases. This is known as the inverse square law.
So the further away you are from the source, the weaker the signal gets.
Exactly. So if we say that the pyramid was transmitting just 1 watt of power, an obelisk that's 10 kilometers away would only receive a tiny fraction of that power.
Like how tiny?
We're talking about 3.18 times 10 to the power of negative 9 watts.
That's practically nothing.
It is incredibly small. But here's where the piezoelectric properties of granite come in again.
Ah, because the obelisks were often made of granite too.
Mm-hmm. Exactly. So even though the amount of energy energy reaching the obelisk is small, that electromagnetic energy could still potentially be converted into tiny electrical charges within the granite.
So it's like a super weak signal, but it's still a signal.
Right. And over time, those charges could accumulate, or maybe they were amplified through some unknown mechanism.
Okay, so we've got this potential energy source, we've got these potential receivers.
Mm-hmm.
But how would the Egyptians have directed this energy to specific obelisks?
Remember those non-uniform micro-movements we saw in the SAR images?
Yeah.
They suggest that the pyramid wasn't radiating energy equally in all directions. It's possible that its eight-sided design with those subtle indentations on each face was acting like a phased array antenna.
A phased array antenna.
Yeah, basically it allows you to focus the energy in specific directions.
Like a beam.
Exactly. And using the wavelength of the Schumann resonance and the spacing between the pyramid's faces, we can actually calculate the beam angle.
What do we get?
We get a very narrow beam angle suggesting that the pyramid could have produced a highly directional beam of energy.
Wow. Okay. So now let's talk about the Ankh. This is where things get really out there. How could this symbol have functioned as a resonance key in this whole energy system?
Well, they think the Ankh shaped that loop and the cross could represent a type of electrical circuit called an LC circuit.
An LC circuit.
Yeah, the loop could act as an inductor and the cross as a capacitor. And if we plug in some hypothetical but reasonable values for the inductance and capacitance, we can calculate a resonant frequency for the Ankh.
Okay, and what do we get?
We get a frequency of about 159 megahertz.
Again, way higher than the Schumann resonance.
Right. So how could this help tune into those lower frequencies? Well, they think the Ankh might have been used to generate acoustic vibrations at those lower frequencies.
Acoustic vibrations like sound.
Exactly. For example, if the Ankh was struck with a sistrum, a type of ancient Egyptian musical instrument.
It could produce sound waves at or near the Schumann resonance frequency.
You got it. Now, the wavelength of a 7.83 hertz sound wave in air is pretty big, around 43.8 meters.
So much bigger than the Ankh itself.
Right, so the Ankh wouldn't be directly emitting this massive sound wave. But the idea is that the vibrations it produced could couple with the physical structure of the obelisk.
Okay, so the Ankh is vibrating, the obelisk is vibrating, and somehow this helps tune the obelisk to the pyramid's frequency.
That's the idea. And this could explain those varying micro-movements we saw in the SAR data. It's like they were fine-tuning the energy network.
This all sounds very Tesla-esque. Did Tesla himself ever talk about the pyramids or ancient technologies?
Not directly, but his ideas about wireless energy and the Earth as a conductor, they're definitely relevant here.
Right, because Tesla was obsessed with tapping into the Earth's natural energy.
Exactly. He believed that the Earth itself could be used as a medium for transmitting electrical energy wirelessly. And his famous Wardenclyffe Tower that was designed to test this theory.
So what was the Wardenclyffe Tower's resonant frequency?
Well, it was 57 meters tall, and its calculated quarter-wave resonant frequency was around 1.32 megahertz.
Again, much higher than the Schumann resonance.
True. But Tesla's goal was to use higher-order modes of resonance to couple with the Earth's electromagnetic field at lower frequencies.
Kind of like what this theory suggests for the pyramid.
Exactly. And if we were to analyze those phase differences in the SAR images using Fourier analysis, we could potentially identify the dominant frequencies present in the pyramid's vibrations. If we found a strong signal near 7.83 hertz, that would be pretty compelling evidence for this resonance theory.
Now, this research also mentions the pyramid's proximity to the Nile River. Could the Nile have played a role in this potential energy transmission?
It's an interesting thought. Water has a very high dielectric constant, which means it affects how electromagnetic waves travel.
So the presence of the Nile could have somehow enhanced the pyramid's energy transmission capabilities.
It's possible. And yeah. Some people have even speculated that those rituals involving the Ankh near the Nile, maybe they were somehow using the water to help tune the obelisks.
Okay, so let's be real here. This is a pretty radical theory. How is it being received by mainstream archaeologists and Egyptologists?
With a lot of skepticism. Most Egyptologists still believe that the pyramids were primarily tombs, and there's no direct archaeological evidence to support the idea that they were used for energy transmission.
Fair enough.
Plus, the energy levels of the Schumann resonance are extremely low. So even if the pyramids were tapping into it, it's unclear how they could have extracted enough energy to power anything significant.
And of course, we have no evidence that the ancient Egyptians had any knowledge of electricity or wireless transmission as we understand them today.
Right, so there are definitely some big hurdles to overcome. But those who support this theory argue that the incredible precision of the pyramid's construction and those subtle micro-movements detected by SAR, they point to something more than just a tomb.
They're saying we need to look at these ancient structures with fresh eyes, considering not just the historical and archaeological evidence, but also the principles of physics and engineering.
Exactly. It's a call for a more interdisciplinary approach to understanding the past.
So to sum up this deep dive, we've looked at the Pyramid of Khufu from a completely new angle, using SAR imaging and some pretty mind-bending math.
Yeah, we've explored the possibility that this ancient wonder might have been some kind of cosmic energy transmitter resonating with the Earth's natural frequencies.
And we've speculated that this energy could have been beamed to obelisks, with the Ankh acting as a tuning key for the whole system.
All very much inspired by the ideas of Nikola Tesla.
Right. Now, it's important to remember that this is all speculative. It's a theory, a very intriguing one, but still just a theory.
We need more research, more data to either confirm or disprove these ideas.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
But it's definitely food for thought. And it makes you wonder what other ancient structures or artifacts might be hiding secrets that we haven't even imagined yet.
What if we're just scratching the surface of what ancient civilizations were capable of?
Exactly. And that's something to ponder. So until next time, keep those minds open and keep exploring.
And maybe start looking at those ancient ruins a little differently.
You never know what secrets they might be hiding.
Exactly.
Thanks for joining us for another deep dive.
See you next time.
See ya.